I'm not trying to brag, but I'm probably moving faster than you right now. What in the world does that mean? Aren't you sitting still and I'm standing still? Think again. You are on a giant space ball, cruising through the vacuum of space around the sun at 67,000 miles per hour. But here's the thing that gives me the edge. I'm recording this in early January, which is actually when the Earth is moving its fastest. So if you're watching this in July, I'm moving faster than you by 2,000 miles per hour. Don't worry, wait till January, you can catch up. Here's the thing, understanding how the planet moves at different speeds during different parts of its orbit is critical to getting Kepler's second law. Let's learn all about this law and get you up to speed. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll introduce Kepler's second law. Kepler's second law can be a little challenging, so we'll state it initially really simply, so it's easy to understand. But then we'll have to add a few details there to make it totally accurate. Secondly, we'll learn to calculate the area of an ellipse, which turns out to be really important for understanding and applying Kepler's second law. And lastly, we'll apply Kepler's second law using what we've learned in part one and part two. To understand Kepler's law, let's begin by considering the Earth's transit during two different times of year. So imagine the Earth going around this elliptical orbit, and it takes about a year to do so, and it goes clockwise. So it'll travel from A to B, and then a little later on, it'll travel from C to D. The thing about these two regions is that they're actually drawn so that they take the same amount of time, about 50 days. So from A to B takes 50 days. And for the Earth to travel from C to D also takes 50 days. So the time period of both is the same. Here's the question. Does the Earth travel faster in the A to B region or the C to D region? Well, you can see pretty clearly that the distance traveled from A to B is longer. So if you travel a farther distance in the same amount of time, you must be moving at a higher speed. Meanwhile, in the C to D region, you're traveling a shorter distance in that same 50 days, and so that must be a slower speed. And so, as an object like the Earth orbits something else, it'll sometimes move faster and sometimes slower. That's true of the Sun and the Earth. It's also true of the Earth and the Moon. So as the Moon orbits around the Earth, it does so in an ellipse, and it moves faster when it's closer to the Earth, and slower when it's farther from the Earth. And that's actually a simple statement of Kepler's second law. An orbiting object varies in speed. That's it. That's easy to understand, right? Sometimes it moves faster, sometimes it moves slower. Okay, let's work towards a more precise statement of Kepler's second law. Here's another question. Which is the larger shaded area, from A to B or C to D? Now, initially you might not be sure, but know something special about these time periods. These time periods are such that the shaded areas are exactly equal. So the shaded areas are equal. And that's actually a more precise statement of Kepler's second law. It says that the area swept out by an orbiting object over a given time is always the same. Whew, that's a lot. The area swept out by an orbiting object over a given time is always the same. That means that the area doesn't vary. And that's precisely because sometimes it moves faster and sometimes it moves slower. So here we have, again, a picture of the Sun and the Earth orbiting around, and three different regions. All of these regions represent the same amount of time period. What's true of their areas? Well, what Kepler's second law says is that the area 1 is equal to area 2 is equal to area 3. So those are all the same. That's what Kepler's second law is saying. That's true when those segments represent equal amounts of time. Whew, okay, I hope you're still with me. Let's just read Kepler's second law one more time. The area swept out by an orbiting object over a given time is always the same. All right, there you have it. That's Kepler's second law. Now, because we're dealing with the area of an ellipse, we need to actually learn to calculate this. So let's remind ourselves about ellipses. Here we have our ellipse. Cool, it's like a stretched circle. And the longer distance is called the major axis. Now remember, in a circle, you have the diameter and then half the diameter is the radius? Same thing here, half the major axis has a special name, the semi-major axis. Now, on the shorter distance across that shape, we have the minor axis. And again, when we take half of it, we get what's called the semi-minor axis. Why is this important? Well, it turns out if you take the semi-major and the semi-minor axes and you multiply them together times pi, you get the area. So the area of an ellipse can be calculated with pi a b. All right, and you need to know how to calculate the area to solve the problems we're going to take a look at with Kepler's second law. And just remember, you multiply the semi-major times the semi-minor axis times pi, and that gives you the area. Now we're ready to put these ideas into practice. This problem says the Earth takes 365 days to complete one orbit of the Sun. The semi-major axis of this orbit, so the longer dimension, is 152 million kilometers. The semi-minor axis of this orbit is 147 million kilometers. What is the area swept out by the Earth in one day? Well, basically what we want to do is take the area of the whole ellipse that the Earth moves in and divide it up into 365 pieces. So the area per day will be equal to the total area divided by the total days. Now, how do we calculate total area of an ellipse? Well, that's pi a b. So we're going to do area per day equals pi a b divided by the total days. Let's plug those variables in one at a time. First up, we have pi. So that's 3.14, and you can use that on your calculator. A, that's the semi-major axis, which is 152 million. Then we'll multiply by b, which is the semi-minor axis, or 147 million. We'll divide that all by the number of days it takes for the Earth to complete one orbit, or 365. There you have it. So once you see it spelled out, not too tough, we want to multiply pi times 152 million times 147 million and then divide by 365. Your calculator will most likely put that directly into scientific notation, and we should get 1.923 times 10 to the 14th kilometers squared. Now, the number of days and the distances of each semi-major and minor axis all have three sig figs, so we want to keep the first three digits there, and we'll round this to 1.92 times 10 to the 14th kilometers squared. Now it's your turn to practice. This problem reads, the Moon takes 27 days to complete one orbit of the Earth. The semi-major axis of this orbit is 384,400 kilometers, that's a lot of kilometers, and the semi-minor axis of this orbit is 383,800 kilometers, also a lot, but just slightly less of kilometers. What area is swept out by the Moon in one day? The steps you'll follow here are very similar to the problem we just did. So if you feel stuck, go ahead and rewatch that segment before coming back here. Now, pause the video, give it a try, and then I'll show you the answer. Were you able to get it? It turns out that the area per day is 1.7 times 10 to the 10th kilometers squared. We solved this problem in a very similar way to our last one. We took the total area and divided by the total days. If you missed this problem, pause the video and compare your steps step by step to see where you made your mistake. Nice job keeping working on this hard. It is tough stuff and takes a lot of effort and repeated practice to get this stuff down. So keep up the good work. What have we learned? Well, we introduced Kepler's second law. And then we learned to calculate the area of an ellipse. And lastly, we applied Kepler's second law. Hey, hey.